Change your heart, Lord, change our heart. You're living in a lawful way. Be mindful of what you say. Be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-mursaleen. Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome to another episode of the Gems of the Heart. One of the extremely difficult problems that a person would have in this life is when he has or when she has a disease and they don't know it. That means they will continue to live their life in a normal way. They won't take the medicine for it. They won't take the means to protect themselves from making it worse and worse, and it can lead them to their own destruction, their own death. So that's why this is something that we have to be very careful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He gave us in our bodies signs that shows that a person is sick or has a problem, so that he would take the means to cure himself or to protect himself from harm's way. But when it comes to our hearts, not the physical aspect of it, but rather the purification of the heart, many of the people on the face of earth, they don't see anything wrong with their hearts. They don't accuse themselves of being arrogant. The arrogant one does not see himself as arrogant. The one that has envy in his heart doesn't see himself as being envious. The one that is not really having the cure and the means of purification of the heart, they don't complain about anything. And that's why the heart is hidden. And the only way for a person to see the means to cure and to take the means of cure is to refer to the revelation from Allah. But also, if a person refers to the revelation from Allah, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, one of the ways to basically purify our hearts is to accuse ourselves in a healthy way that we have all the diseases of the heart. Basically, to take the means to cure our hearts from all the diseases of the heart. So for example, the worst disease in the heart is a shirk, to associate partners with Allah. If a person would say, I'm not a mushrik, I'm not upon polytheism, I'm a Muslim, alhamdulillah, I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, I do not associate partners with Allah. But if a person leaves himself like this, he can be, you know, taken into the steps of shaitan one after the other, especially when with the lack of knowledge, and so that the person might fall, or even he might have some minor shirk and he's not aware of it. So the way to protect ourselves is to take the means to protect ourselves from this fatal disease of the heart, and that is the shirk, to associate partners with Allah. That means to do the opposite of it, to be upon the tawheed, and to learn how to warn ourselves from a shirk and associating partners with Allah, and so on. To accuse oneself of, not necessarily to accuse ourselves, but to take the means that if a person has arrogance in his heart, he would do certain things to purify his heart from arrogance. Whether a person knows that he's arrogant, which is rarely happens, the most arrogant person, he would say that he's the most humble, right? So each and everyone should take the means to cure one's heart from arrogance. And if a person has arrogance, mashallah, this will be great. If he doesn't have it, this is the mean to protect his heart from having arrogance in it. Because the shaitan is constantly working to pollute our hearts. And this is basically the main concern of the shaitan, of the Satan, of the devil. He might make the person fall into a sin physically, but the objective of the shaitan is the heart. This is the way of the shaitan to get into the heart, by making the person committing physical sins. So when a person protects his heart, when he's aware of this, then he will protect himself from the plots and the steps of the shaitan. And one of which is to get to know the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. When a person knows the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, he would know how to act accordingly. He would know how to deal with things that we as human beings, we fail miserably if we do not follow the wahi, the revelation from Allah. And that's what's happening to humanity, unless they follow the light of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. One of which is the subject of al-fitan. Al-fitan, trials, tribulations, the things that might be very confusing to many, what to do in these situations, whether it's affecting a nation or the entire world or an individual, how to deal with these tribulations and trials and things that becomes very confusing. Because the word fitna or al-fitan has many different meanings if we look into the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And it can affect one's individual, you know, heart, and can affect one's, you know, the entire ummah of the Prophet ﷺ or the entire world. That's why we have to be aware of it and how to deal with it and how to define actually what is fitna and what is not. What is a tribulation? What is a trial for one's iman and faith and what's not? But when we see this life that we live in, everything is a trial for us. And that's why the fitan in the general terms is basically the entire life that a person lives in. Tests in general is considered to be fitan. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ, which means we will try you with evil and goodness as a fitna, as a fitna, as a trial for you. And the word fitna here, that means evil things and good things are fitna. But what is the real essence of the word fitna? There are many different meanings to it, but one of the root meaning of the word fitna, it's used when the gold is being tested to see if it's fake or it's real. And they would heat it into high temperatures. So there's fire, there is the gold, which is something that is precious, and it's to be heated to high temperatures so that the fake one would be clearly distinct from the real and the original gold. The same thing when it comes to the subject of al-fitan. There is this subject of being going through struggle. This is like the fire. These are the trials. These are the tests that a person would face in his life. That doesn't look good, that doesn't taste good. It's like fire, really, that a person is, but when he's thrown into the fire, he's burned, he's suffering. That's what fitan is, something that can look like this. Apparently looks like it's a difficult one. But this fitan, as it does to the gold, it purifies it from what is fake, from the dirt of it, from what contaminates it, so that the pure gold stays. The same thing, this is what the fitan does to the believers, or does to the nations in general. That means those who are fake, they will be exposed. Those who are fake will, you know, fail in facing the fitan. And the pure, those who are pure among the believers, those who will come out of the fitan as being pure, as reviving their iman, but with the knowledge of how to face it or how to deal with it. Because one of the confusing matters is when it comes to fitan, the general rulings, and again this can be different to specific individuals, but the general rulings of it is to stay away from it. This is what a Muslim should do with all kinds of fitan, not to seek to be tested, not to face tribulations, not to face things that might make him confused or have doubts or things of that nature, but rather to stay away from it. To stay away from it to protect our hearts from being affected by the tribulations and the trials that people face every day. We are living at a time when the entire fitan and trials and tribulations of the whole world can be presented to oneself in his own palm. When he looks into the phone and the smartphones and the social media and the internet and all of this new life that people are experiencing, things that used to happen far away distance from oneself, and now he can see it immediately, he can be affected by it immediately. Someone would say something, words of evil, words of deviation, that he might deviate or affect people from a distance. They have to be present with him physically. Nowadays, everything's accessible. Anybody can say anything in the East and West, and everybody can be affected by it. And it's not necessarily what is good is being affecting others, but also the evil and the bad things. So that's why we have to be aware of this. We have to be aware of the fitan. We have to protect ourselves and to be patient in taking the means to cure ourselves from the diseases of the heart, and to be patient with the revelation of Allah, even if we don't see with our own reasons how that was going to save us. And this concept has been mentioned before many, many times. We are tested as believers the same way the people, they were tested by the Ark of Nuh alayhi salam. That he was building a ship in a desert. that has no means to it whatsoever, people would never think that why he is building a ship in the desert. And that's why they make mockery of him. They ridiculed him. And he's a prophet of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have made him do something else. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed it to be such a miraculous thing, of course, but a severe trial to the people. Why? Because if they use their own intellect and reason only, it's very obvious that he's doing something that doesn't make sense. Why is he building a ship in the desert? But he did that because of what he knows from the revelation from Allah. So when the things happened and the flood happened, who were saved? Those who were in the ship. And those who drowned, those who did not follow Nuh alayhi salam, those who they ridiculed him. So it's really, this is basically what's this deen for the Muslim. This is what Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, when he talked about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that this, the Ark of Nuh is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for this ummah. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the Ark of Nuh for the people of Nuh. It's the same thing. Are you basically preparing yourself to be ridiculed there, to be looked down upon, right? Because a person might do something that doesn't make sense to the people because they don't know the outcome of things. They don't know the nature of fitna. The masses, they might see a fitna as a good thing, but it leads them astray. How can a person be aware of this when it's very confusing? If a person referred to the revelation from Allah, to the wahi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And again, there are many of this, but mainly specifically with regards to the fitan, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called it, tamuj kamawj al-bahr. It's like the waves of the sea. When a person is in the midst of waves of the ocean, for example, he's not able to control himself. It takes him to the right, to the left, deeper into the sea without having any control. He cannot really oppose the power of the sea by swimming or by, you know, working on himself to run away from it. It becomes overpowering for him. And how to deal with these types of fitan? And when we talk about fitna, and we're not necessarily talking about it in the way that, you know, many would mention it with the different meanings of it in the Quran and things of that nature on a person level, on the entire ummah level. And as we said in the beginning, that it has to do with fire. And that means something that a person might suffer, might go through difficulties or pain. But there is a good thing in it, and that is it's purify one's heart. And this is basically the trials that a person sees in this life, or the tribulations that a person or an entire nation can face. It doesn't look good, it doesn't feel good, it might be lots of suffering, but the outcome of it is definitely good, but only for the believers. For those who they know how to deal with it and how to stay away from it and when to be part of things and how to take means to protect ourselves from the trials and the tribulations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned it so that we do not think that nobody is going to be tested in this life. Everybody is going to be tested in this life, and there's no running away from it. Especially the more the person perfects his iman and faith, the more that he will be tested. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا أَمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people think that they will be left to say amanna, we believe, and they're not going to be tested? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear that he tested those who were before. So this is part of al-faith or al-iman. So do people think that they will be left to say amanna, وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ, and they won't be afflicted by fitan, meaning that they would not be tried and tested? وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَا يَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَا يَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَذِبِينَ. This is the benefit or the wisdom behind the fitan, is that becomes clear those who are truthful versus those who are liars. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows from the beginning, before the test, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish his creation based on his previous knowledge, but rather based on their actions after the matter becomes very clear to them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioning this in the Quran so that nobody would have confusion, or so that nobody would think that this life is like the Jannah in the hereafter, that it's supposed to be just an enjoyment and things like this. And that's why they deceive themselves, they ruin themselves, those who their objective in this life is to have fun, is to enjoy it into the ultimate sense. that this is what drives them. That means they would fall into sins, because if enjoyment is the goal of this life, a person would follow his desires. That feels good, that tastes good, that looks good. Regardless whether this is permissible or not permissible, whether it leads to one's death or destruction physically, or to one's ruining his own iman and his faith with something that haram, that is not permissible for him to do. So the objective of this life is to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then there is the circumstances, the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for the people, and they are all tested by it for them to be patient with regards to the orders of Allah and to follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times and at all levels. Because of the nature of the subject, and it's a very detailed one, and there are many verses in the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet that mentions this, we need to really hold fast to the deen of Allah. We need to follow the al-athar. Al-athar in the sense that we follow the footsteps of those who came before us, meaning the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the early generations of Al-Islam, and to be patient with following the deen of Al-Islam in that manner, even if there are kinds of temptations for a person to change. And that's why the only way that a person would do this is to follow the people of knowledge. The people of knowledge, the knowledge of the deen of Al-Islam, the knowledge of the revelation from Allah, not the people of information, that they have some information and they deal with the reality of the people with the lack of the proper knowledge. And that's why we have to prepare ourselves sometimes that the people of knowledge might say to the people something that might not make sense to them. It's not contradicting to their own senses and reason, because the deen of Al-Islam is perfectly with the proper reason. But when it comes to the outcome, you don't know the end of your road or your path. So how can you make an assumption that this is what would lead us, or this what would take us to our destination or not? You do not know the way. You have to know the way, and you know that this will take you to the final destination, and that is by being obedient to Allah. And there are many verses in the Quran that gives that meaning. وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَل لَّهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Whoever is obedient to Allah, fears Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make ways out for him, and he would provide for him from ways that he does not expect. And that's not something that a person would physically see, but rather by knowing this from the wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will give an example from an authentic hadith that reported by Imam Ahmad and others, and it's a sound hadith, and I would read it to you so that we can see what to do in situations where things are confusing. And I'm not saying that we'll be able in like this episode and the like of it to mention all the different fitan that people see in this life nowadays, but just to give a general idea of when things are confusing, what to do. Of course, asking the people of knowledge, make things not really confusing or anything. But the Prophet ﷺ, when the fitna was mentioned, the trials and the tribulations, he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, and I would read to you, he said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ النَّاسَ قَدْ مَرَجَتْ عُهُودُهُمْ وَخَفَّتْ أَمَانَتُهُمْ. The Prophet ﷺ said, if you see the people that their covenants have been mixed and not really, they're not taking their covenants seriously between one another or between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're not really trustworthy anymore, and their amana, their trust has becomes weak, whether in dealings and transactions, in their obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَكَانُوا هَكَذَا وَشَبَّكَ بَيْنَ أَصَابِعِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, and they became like this, and he made his hands like forelock like this. That means things becomes all over the place. Things becomes very confusing, and nobody knows what's right and what's wrong and who's good and who's bad and things like this. So the companion of the Prophet ﷺ, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, he said, I stood up and I said, O Prophet of Allah, كَيْفَ أَفْعَلُ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ جَعَلَنِ اللَّهُ فِدَكَ. What to do when I see this, when I witness this, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me or sacrifice my life for you, saying that to the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ said to him something, right? Of course, what is mentioned in the beginning here, we have to really understand it well, so that we don't apply the cure or what the Prophet ﷺ said based on something else, right? So is this is really what a person sees in his life? If it's true, that a person thinks becomes very confusing, he doesn't know what is right and what is wrong, alhamdulillah, things are not that severe to many of us. There's still the people of knowledge are in abundance on the face of earth, and a person need to be aware of the truth and to be obedient to Allah. But the answer of the Prophet ﷺ gives us an idea to remove ourselves from many of the things that makes us more confused in this life. The Prophet ﷺ, he said to him, "Ilzam baytak," stay in your home, meaning do not face these types of trials and tribulations and put yourself into harm's way. Do not harm your religion. Do not be at ease by going to places, whether it's physically or virtually, that you know that is going to harm your religion. You know, and again, as we said earlier, we don't have to physically go somewhere. Of course, there are physical places where you know that your religion, your faith, might be challenged in it, meaning sins, sinful acts, people that are saying bad things about the deen of Allah and things like this. You stay away from it. It's a very clear concept. Unless for, you know, individuals, counted individuals, that they might change that evil by inviting others to the truth. They have, the knowledge that they would, make the matter very clear to the people, and then they state their truth and they leave. They don't sit with the people when they are committing evil and disbelief and things like this. And we're living at times, as we said, what used to be has to be in a physical presence. The same rules applies when people are in the virtual world. So when people start arguing and talking about matters of major matters, matters of the religion, the truth, falsehood, nations, politics, governments, when they're not well informed. And we're living at times when people are much less informed than before because there's so much deception. So then everybody starts speaking. Everybody would have an opinion. Everybody would have a say. And this can cause so much fitan and tribulations, even bloodshed. So a person, when he sees the matter like this, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ilzam baytak." So this is a way that we need to constantly, always, taken means of protecting our iman and ourselves by making our homes healthy in matters of iman, worshipping Allah. We'll talk about this, inshallah ta'ala, continuing the hadith, inshallah ta'ala, after the break. So stay with us, inshallah. Change your heart, Lord, change our heart. Change your heart, Lord, change our heart. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ba'd. We're talking about the fitan and tribulations in a very specific manner. And we were talking about a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he said to the companions radiallahu anhum, when you see things are confusing and people, they're not respecting their covenants and they're not trustworthy and things becomes very confusing, what to do in these situations? He said, "Ilzam baytak," stay in your home. And we talked about that this is requires knowledge and what is meant or benefiting from this so that we don't fall into some extremism or so, that a person should really secure the places where we have control over it. We have to have a controlled environment, if it's correct to say, and now we're living at times when really our own environment, to a great extent, we don't have a control over it. When the entire world again is in our hands, when we look into things and the internet and the like of this, and our children are being exposed to all kinds of things. We have to make sure that our homes are protected from fitan. We should not make the fitan enter into our homes. You know, then what is the difference between someone staying in his home or being outside? It becomes the same thing? It shouldn't. As one of the people, he asked one of the great scholars, and he asked him, "Can I take my children, my family, and live somewhere outside of the city where I can protect them from all kinds of fitan and deviant things and things of that nature?" The Shaykh talks about the different evidences and so on, how the believer, those who mix with others and is patient with them is better than the believer, the one that isolates himself and he's safe from them. Definitely, and this is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. But if a person is not able to protect his iman and his faith, that's the most precious thing. And not to say, well, that's how it is. And if people are affecting my iman and my deen, I will continue to mix with them in a negative way and I would lose my religion. No one with a sound mind would ever say that, let alone having faith and iman. To protect one's iman in the proper way with the proper knowledge. But one of the things that he said to him What's the benefit if you take yourself and your family, for example, to live in the outskirts of the city that has so much evil in it that is taking you away from your deen, when you take with you everything else like the phones and the tablets and the computers and so on, and you allow everything to be accessible to them as if you did not really go anywhere? And this is the level of tribulations that we're facing nowadays, that we have to make sure that we apply these ahadith of the Prophet so that we protect ourselves from what is evil and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us from. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he mentioned the hadith that we were talking about, and that the people, then he should ilzam baytak, he said alayhi salatu wasalam, wa amsik lisanak, and hold your tongue. Do not make yourself in haste in saying things, because things can be very devastating to one's iman, or even physically. That's why when we say that, you know, people, they talk and they talk easily, and they might not be even talking in a way that in this life that people are physically talking. Many things are behind, you know, screens and things like this. A person should be able to control himself and to control his tongue when at times of fitan. And again, since we're not talking, or we didn't talk about the different examples of fitan and tribulations, we're talking more about the cure. But this is general terms that we need to do, and by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we'll find ourselves being protected. We need to make sure that we purify our homes from sins and from things that can be dangerous for one's iman. We need to control our tongues, وَأَمْلِكْ عَلَيْكَ لِسَانَكَ, to have control over one's tongue. And خُذْ بِمَا تَعْرِفَ, and the Prophet ﷺ said, take what you know, وَدَعْ مَا تُنْكِرْ, and leave what you really not knowing. Meaning, مَا تَعْرِفْ, not what you personally as an individual with the lack of knowledge you would know, but rather it means things that are clear in the religion, take that and do that. There is salah, there is the adhan, there is the masjid. It's very obvious. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. You fulfill the obligations, you go to the masjid, you pray with the people, and you enjoin good and forbid evil, you do what is good. And again, the matter is not as a person might think that it's very severe. No, the matter is good, alhamdulillah, and there's always goodness, you know, among the Muslims. But the point here is there are very obvious things that sometimes we ignore, and we become indulgent into things that are confusing. Leave what's confusing and be in the clear matters. And many people, they make themselves busy with things that is not really for them. You know, when someone, for example, is not a doctor, why does he need to be concerned of giving prescription to people? Right? You know how that's illegal for, you know, almost in every country on the face of earth. Imagine someone is giving prescriptions for people, or even making surgeries for people, when he's not in that profession. That's a very dangerous thing. Very dangerous for himself and for others. And the same thing when it comes to someone being in the position of a judge when he's not a judge, or someone giving a fatwa when he's not in the position of being a mufti, for example. You know, things like this, a person has to be aware and to stay away from it. Not just in the individual level, but also, and I, you know, this is maybe a subject that many people might have issues with. You know, it's very easy. You find almost every gathering, or when the Muslims, they get together, they talk about politics. What do we know about things in details that would allow us to make decisions, right? Or to say this is right and this is wrong, and this is the conspiracy theory that this is happening this way or that way. And many of these talks are not based on anything. It's just based on assumptions, and people start hating one another, and the Muslims becomes having hatred against one another with parties and all kinds of things based on things that has no basis to it whatsoever. And that's why a person has to be away from all of these fitan and to protect his iman and his faith and to be busy with what we need to be busy with. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, وَعَلَيْكَ بِأَمْرِ خَصَّةِ نَفْسِكَ وَدَعْ عَنْكَ أَمْرَ الْعَامَّ. If you see the matter confusing like this, be more focused on the special things, the your family, your surroundings, you know, the things that you have control over, and leave the masses, or leave the affairs of the masses of the people. Of course, this is not a call for a Muslim to isolate himself or to live in a bubble. But the point here is not everybody can really benefit the entire Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, in the sense that he knows what is right and what is wrong in this situation in the East and the West and so on. And everybody has a say, and everybody become, you know, in state of hatred against others and so on, when nobody is really well, many people are not well informed. Plus, we ignore many of the basic things in matters of the religion, and one of which is if we change within ourselves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change our situation. But in these matters, we should refer to the people of knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran. وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِنَ الْأَمْنِ أَوْ الْخَوْفِ أَذَاعُوا بِهِ وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَى أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ. That means when a matter of security or a matter of fear comes to them, what happened? أَذَاعُوا بِهِ. They circulated. They make it so much widespread. Matters that affects their community, affects their countries and things like this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ. If they refer it back to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِلَىٰ أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ, and to those who are in charge of them, لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ, then those who can extract the rulings with knowledge, they would know it. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَاتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. And if it wasn't the bounty and the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, that you would follow the shaitan, most of you, illa qalil, except little. So the point here is, the ayah clearly states this, and it's something that happened at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. So when there is matter that is affecting the entire ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, fitan and tribulations and so on, it is not for myself and yourself and, you know, normal people that we will talk about the matter. We have to have a statement in everything that people faces without referring to the people of knowledge, without referring to the people of authorities, you know, in matters of ma'ruf and goodness. This has caused chaos among the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, and that's what's happening. So this is really a sincere advice to follow the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to follow our ulama, our people of knowledge, and to be busy with what concerns us. And it's not a call to be negative or to be not really proactive in things and things like that nature, but we have to move with clear evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and to follow the ways of the Prophet ﷺ, and to be patient in this, and to make sure that the most important and the most precious thing in our life is our religion, is to protect our hearts. And that's what the fitan or the tribulations, it takes the one's iman from the heart. So the person has to make sure that it's protected. So the point of all of this, again, it's not a call to do one specific action or the other, but to be aware that things are not as easy as we think when it comes to the fitan and tribulations. And instead of being indulged into things that is not going to benefit us, but rather might harm us, a person should be really busy with one's faith and one's iman, and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to make sure that we do not expose ourselves to the fitan and the tribulations, especially when matters are very confusing. And as the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ شُحًّا مُطَاعًا وَهَوًا مُتَّبَعًا, that if you see greed that is being obeyed, the greed of the individual that is being obeyed, and desires that are being followed, وَعْجَابُ كُلِّ ذِي رَأْيٍ بِرَأْيٍ, and you see everybody is amazed and likes their own opinions, and they follow their own opinions, and they're not necessarily following the truth. What to do about in these matters? And this is very clearly when people, for example, look into the, you know, something like the social media, for example, when everybody argues and talks, and people keep on going back and forth with their statements, analyzing every single political situations, and giving their own opinions of what needs to be done here or there, without having the knowledge of it, without asking their elders, the people of knowledge, things of that nature. And you would find people fighting over these matters based on greed that they have, based on their desires that is being followed. So if you see the matter like this, then what should you do? The Prophet ﷺ said, فَعَلَيْكَ بِنَفْسِكَ وَدَعْ عَنْكَ أَمْرَ الْعَامَّةِ. That means be concerned about, focus on yourself, and leave these matters that makes, you know, people are not listening. This is to understand this hadith in the proper way, so that nobody would say, then where is the enjoining good and forbidding evil and making da'wah and so on? This is in the case when a person presented the truth, if it's a matter of truth versus falsehood, and people, they didn't accept it or they rejected it and so on. you know, to make sure that the matter becomes clear and he can go further step to make it clear to them. But once the desires are being followed and things like this, a person should refrain. He made the matter very clear to them. If he's among those who have that ability to do so, and not every single Muslim is required to be in that, you know, level of enjoining good and forbidding evil, especially when it comes that things that are affecting the entire ummah. We're not talking about someone that knows. We all know that the salah is obligatory. So if you see someone that is neglecting his salah, you should advise them, take the means, you know, especially if that person is close, to advise them, to remind them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to call them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on. But we're talking about the things that many people, it does not really concern them, or if it concerns them, they're not really well informed of it, or they don't have the knowledge of it. So instead of, you know, falling into the trap of being busy with dividing the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ and to be confused about matters, but to focus on one's religion, to protect oneself from the fitan and the tribulations, and to understand there are fitan and tribulations that affects the people. One of which is that when things becomes very confusing, and this is one of the signs of the hour. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, and the Prophet ﷺ told us that it's going to be fitan. They're going to be fitan. There's going to be trials. And the way to protect ourselves is to stay with the Muslimin, not to oppose the Muslimin, and to be kind and to be gentle in matters. Do not rush into things. Seek the knowledge. Seek the people of knowledge, and to humble oneself with matters of the deen, and not to rush into making things, otherwise a person can be taken away into these fitan and these tribulations. The way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of earth with regards to the fitan, as we said, that it splits the people. Some people, they fall into these fitan, and the fitan would lead them astray. They might leave the fold of Islam. They might take the path of the extremists, where they thought they know exactly the matter, what it is, and they end up being like the Khawarij and the like of them, fighting the believers and causing all kinds of harm to their nations and things like this, not, you know, understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or falling into the other extreme, neglecting the religion, saying the religion causes all kinds of trouble, so that they would neglect the religion, turn away from the truth, turn away from being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the individuals, they need to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to repent to Allah. We need to be obedient to Allah, to establish the salah. Why there is, you know, people, you would find them, you know, with the obligations that they have during the day, it is not fulfilled. And they would sit and they would make all kinds of arguments of what is best for this ummah, the Prophet ﷺ, and the Muslims need to do this and need to do that. And the time of the salah comes and a person neglects his salah, or does not pray in the proper way. He does not go to the masjid, to the house of Allah. You know, does not do the ibadah that he needs to do, not reading Quran, not increasing one's reward. So again, it's a call to know what is our positions, and to make sure that we increase our knowledge, but to be patient with the orders of Allah, and to know that there are fitan and tribulations. If a person wants to learn it, it's basically learning the deen and learning what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Haram would never lead to something good. So there's no way that a person would think at times of fitan it's okay to commit sins. Why? Because this would lead us to something good. There's no such a thing. This is the lack of knowledge that would make the person think this way. That's why when a person is upon knowledge, he will be patient. And to the extent of which even a person is ready, which is again something that many people might misunderstand it. But we're living at a world again, than people that can read anything. And they might misunderstand some of the ayat of the Quran or the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That's why a person should ask the people of knowledge, even with things that are related to him. When the Prophet ﷺ said, for example, in the authentic hadith, that يُوشِكُ أَنْ يَكُونَ خَيْرُ مَالِي الْمُسْلِمِ, that very soon the best of the wealth of the Muslim, غَنَمْ يَتْبَعُ بِهَا شَعْفَ الْجِبَلِ, that he would have some goats and sheep, that he follows the tops of the mountains seeking provisions for it. That's the best of his wealth. Why? وَمَوَاقِعَ الْقَطْرِ, and following the rain falls and things like this. Why would a person want to do that? And it's not a call for anyone to do that, right? We're supposed to mix with the people and live what people normally live. We do not forbid what Allah made it permissible for us, right? The worldly matters, if it's, you know, we use the television, microphone, all these types of technologies, everything is fine, everything is, it's not haram, unless it's used for something that is forbidden. But the point here is these types of hadith shows that the most important thing for us in this life is our religion. So the Prophet ﷺ said, when he talks about a specific situation that might happen to someone, or at specific times or specific situations, that the best of one's wealth is some goats and sheep that he follows the rainfalls. That means he left the people, he isolated himself. Why would a person want to do that? The Prophet ﷺ, he said clearly, يَفِرُّ بِدِينِهِ مِنَ الْفِتَنِ. He's fleeing with his religion from al-fitan and tribulation. He flees from the tribulations to protect his religion, to save his religion. So what is the hadith is saying to us? It says to us there is nothing in this world of a value that is worth it for a person to lose his religion. So that means be obedient to Allah. And nothing that is worth it for a person to compromise his religion, whether it's with a word of mouth or with an action that a person do. And again, when we're talking, we're not talking about, you know, or addressing leaders necessarily or specific individuals in a society. We're talking about the masses of the Muslims, right? That means we as masses of the Muslims, we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to be obedient to Allah and to be obedient to our leaders in matters of ma'ruf and matters of goodness, not in sins. In sins, no obedience to anyone, but the obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone in the absolute sense. And to follow the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be obedient to Allah, and to follow the people of knowledge and things of that nature, and to protect ourselves from the fitan and the tribulations that doesn't cause anything but evil and worse evil and so on. And there's nothing wrong for a person to understand what's happening around them, and that the reason why there is fitan and tribulations is to test the people, yes, and that it's very easy for a person to slip away, you know, as a result of the fitan, and to know that the sins of the people would be the means to increase the fitan and the tribulations, and that the person needs to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the obedience of Allah, with acts of obedience to Allah, and to give charity and to make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to seek knowledge and to be obedient to Allah. And this is our life, and this is the life of the believers, to protect themselves from the fitan. Going specific to specific examples, then this is where we refer to the people of knowledge and to be patient with following the matters of knowledge and the obedience to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the fitan and to make us among those who have the proper knowledge and to follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa barakatuh. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mindful of what you say, be sincere when you pray. Today could be your last day. Bear each other no malice. Greed and faith can coexist in the same heart. Change your heart.